It is my great pleasure to present my talk as a Vebleo fellow in this program. So I came from the University of Queensland. So you know, the Queensland is in the Brisbane in Australia Island. And you know, Australia Island in the southern hemisphere of the earth. So everybody, yeah, welcome to visit University of Queensland. I'm happy to receive you. So in this talk, I will talk about five parts. So in the part one, just a tumor and nanotechnology. And the second part, we'll introduce a specific clay nanoparticles, layer double hydroxide, LDH, and their cellular uptake. And third part, I will introduce how to use LDH nanoparticles for blood circulation. And the fourth part, I will have some examples for in vivo therapy, cancer therapy, and the imaging. And in the final part, I will present a strategy to enhance LDH nanoparticles accumulation in tumor microenvironment. As you know, tumor microenvironment is a very complex environment. And it has a very specific features. I think in the first features is leaking vessels and has a less lymphatic draining. And second part, second feature is acidity. It's different from normal tissues, it's 7.5. And in tumor microenvironment, the pH is about 6.5 to 6.8. So this acidity enabled many scientists to design pH sensitive nanomaterials for drug delivery to prohibit cancer growth. And also in tumor microenvironment, there is a hypoxia, an unbalanced redox species, as well as a unbalanced cytokines. So these provide a lot of targets for scientists to design many different kinds of particles for better cancer diagnosis and therapy. And you know, cancer electronology, nanotechnology is a interdisciplinary technology combine science, engineering, and nanomedicine with the capacity for providing new tools to fight cancers. As shown in this figure, say for cancer, for diagnosis or treat cancers, we need several tools. And these tools are actually can provide by nanotechnology in different ways to enhance cancer diagnosis and imaging and therapeutics. Actually, in the last 20, 25 years, there is about 20 nanomedicines that are approved by FDA or other agency to use for human clinic. Most nanoparticles actually are lipsum-based, and some are albumin-based. Only a few, say iron oxide or gold nanoparticles. So there are some particles that are already used, and it's true, these nanomedicines enhance the cancer therapy. So LDH nanoparticles is a specific clay. And this is actually is very similar to brucite in the structure. And this is a brucitinase magnesium hydroxide. In each octahedral, there's one magnesium and surrounded by six OH groups. So when they share edge and form two-dimensional sheets, this is a charged neuron. Now, if magnesium is replaced by aluminum, so that octahedral will become positive charged. And this will absorb some iron and water molecules and form a sandwich-like structure. So if more layers come together, they form a three-dimensional nanocrystals. So one particular properties is the ion can be exchanged. So these properties can enable us to load DNA, RNA, drugs, proteins, and some dyes that mostly carry negative charge or zeta ion charge. So this can be a very good, very efficient carrier for those species. And we know in the nature, there is a mineral called hydrotelluride. It is a magnesium, aluminum, hydroxide, carbonate, hydrate. So in the laboratory, for biomedical purpose, we normally make magnesium, aluminum, magnesium ion system, but for some functional particles, we can make some other divalent or trivalent cations loaded or incorporate LH system. I will show you some examples in my late talk. So in the laboratory, we can make LDH nanoparticles very easily with the size. So these particles actually is most, in most case, is a sheet-like morphology. And the size can be readily tuned from 30 nanometers up to a few micrometers. And the dispersion can be almost mono dispersed with the average size, say from 20 nanometers to about 2 micrometers. So we can make this very easily in the laboratory. And this is about 15 years ago's work. We have a patent and also some publications to report these new findings. And these nanoparticles actually can be easily taken up by mammalian cells, say the NIH, cells, you see the green color, we loaded FITC, a dye, into the LDH nanoparticles. And this is a green fluorescence, show the nanoparticles are taken up by the cells. So this is a dynamic monitoring of the particles uptake by the cells. So the overall uptake by the cells, you see, increase very quickly in the first hour and extend to up to 8 hours. So in the first hour, we see there's about 80-70% of saturated taking amount can take up by the cells. So this is a very quick process. Why? So that is possibly the reasons these nanoparticles have anti-acidification and help nanoparticles to undergo endosome escape. Here we find, say, we use aluminum, albumin. That actually is particles about 3 to 5 nanometers. LDH is about 100 nanometers. We use a cell to take up. We can see, so use FITC to tag the BSA. We see in albumin case, the green color is quite low. Why in LDH, you see the green color is very strong. Actually, that green color proportional to the uptake amount of albumin. So that actually is about 8 to 10 times difference. So this is very strong facilitation for the uptake of albumin by cells. So what happened to the system? We know the when the nanoparticles are taken by the cells, they will form an endosome. In endosome, LDH is a weak base, will neutralized by pumped protons. So that will release some anion species. So that anion species in the endosome increase, that will enable water to influx. So that will expand the endosome's volume and then finally burst and release LDH into the site source. So that just undergoes endosome. So this just show here that lysosome marker, we didn't see any lysosome here, but in the album case, we see a red viscose, that is lysosomes. So we're mostly sure that albumin uptake undergoes a lysosome escape, while LDH-based nanoparticles just undergoes endosome escape. These facilitate the uptake of the particles. So these are very specific properties for these LDH nanoparticles. So these are two examples for two therapeutics delivery. So first we load, for example, 5FU, actually is an anti-cancer drug. We can use an ion exchange to load into the layers, and then we can load siRNA on the surface or on the edge. So this siRNA is a function, have a function against cancers. And then we do some delivery test, core delivery test. So we deliver these nanoparticles and to monitor the cell viability and plot the cell viability concentration or dose dependence and profile. So after the cell uptake for 24 hours, and then we check cell viability. These are breast cancer cells. Because they are 5FU, actually is anti-cancer drugs. So as the 5FU, free 5FU concentration increase, the cell viability decrease. So say around 10 microgram per mil, we see that's about 40% of cancer cells are killed. So now if 5FU are loaded onto the LDH nanoparticles and the same dose, we see about 20-30% of cancer cells are killed by LDH particles. So these show the LDH particles facilitation for drug delivery into the cancer cells and kill more cancer cells. Further, we load a functional siRNA that can also kill part of our cancer cells. At 40 nanomole, we see there's about 30% of cancer cells are killed. So combined with the 5FU in LDH nanoparticles, we see at the same dose of 5FU, we can see a lot, 10 to 20% of cancer cells are killed by these nanoparticles. So especially, specifically at low concentration, the significant difference we can clearly observe. So in terms of IC50, the 5FU actually has a more than 10 microgram per mil concentration, but in the LDH form, that reduced to one, that's a 10 times reduced. If core delivery with siRNA, we see this reduce a lot, three times. So this is a very efficient core delivery of 5FU and siRNA to breast cancer cells. Actually, this LDH nanoparticles mechanism aluminum LDH. So it's a very biocompatible. So for example, for the smooth muscle cells, at very high concentration, 500 microgram per mil, and incubate for 6 days, we see the cell viability almost over 90%. So that means does not affect the cell viability if just carrier LDH as a carrier, and also very compatible with blood. So here just show the hemolysis rate. See at the concentration up to 800 microgram per mil, we see the hemolysis rate is less than 10%. So this just show LDH nanoparticles are very compatible. So, and these particles actually in the electrolyte solution, some, for example, PBS solution and culture medium, they're very easily aggregate to a micro or even 10 micro size. So, into large in these aggregates, some possibly cause blood vessel blocking, or even mice deaths. Actually, in the very beginning, in about 2005, we inject nanoparticles and cause my stress, say after 3 minutes post injection. So this is a big problem we have to solve. Actually, how to maintain the colloidal stability, say in the blood and PBS, as an individual particles. Actually, my colleague Professor Choi actually used ABTS to coat it on LDH particles. And my group also use a silica dose to coat it on LDH particle surface. That can stabilize and also will deliver drug carrier payload to the cell system. However, this modification involve a long acquired solvent, some organic solvent, so it's not good. And also the process takes a long time. So definitely it is not good for some biomolecular loaded, drug loaded, after a long time process in non-acquired solvent. Luckily, later on we use the album, for example, BSA coating, and find that coat can well stabilize LDH nanoparticles. So here we test the LDH nanoparticles to absorb BSA in different concentration. We see these are actually is that absorption is a typical Langmuir absorption and behavior. So we use a Langmuir to simulate this process and find the maximum absorption amount is a 0.7 milligram BSA per milligram LDH. And this LDH actually is 110 nanometers, okay? So this absorption amount actually is very, very large, very, very high compared to many other particles. And very interestingly, we find at low free BSA concentration, the LDH particles agglomerate to some degree, aggregate. However, at high concentration, free concentration, we find they're very stable. They're colloid stable. And even this stable put into PBS, they're still stable. So we explain because in low concentration, possibly BSA is not more than enough. So some particles share album and have some bridge effect and agglomerate. On the other hand, at a high concentration, each particle is absorbed to maximum amount. So that biopolymer on particle surface produce some steric effect and stabilize the particles. Here is the visual image. You see, LDH particles we can make a very well dispersed in pure water, but put in the PBS, we can see agglomerate very easily. And then we use a BSA to coat on surface and get a very well dispersed, and even put mixed with PBS solution, we can still see a well dispersed nanoparticles. So this technology help us to solve the agglomeration of nanoparticles in electrolyte solution, as well as serum medium, serum, as well blood. After coating BSA, actually the part cellular uptake does not affect. So here, after coating 1 hour, 24 hours, the cell uptake actually is quite similar. In terms of amount, yeah, the 1 hour and 24, even 24 hours after coating, they take up a little bit more than the blank one. Okay, so BSA coating on LDH nanoparticles does not affect the cellular uptake of LDH nanoparticles. Okay, so now I will show some examples for in vivo imaging and therapy. So the strategy to load drugs as well as some protein or vaccines. So here we just summarize here for imaging. So as I just showed, BSA can be readily coated on surface. So if we carry some peptide, some drugs, some antigens and ligand onto the BSA and load on this BSA on LDH particle surface, we can achieve, say, chemotherapy, vaccines, and as well as a toxin delivery. And then we can also load 5FU or genes or dye between the layers for drug delivery, for dye delivery. Moreover, we can replace magnesium with copper, manganese for imaging as well as for photothermal therapy. So we can functionalize LDH particles with various ways. And so this is very interesting system. It can deliver, can be a delivery vehicle or vaccine adjuvant. Today, I just show some in vivo delivery vehicles for imaging as well as chemotherapy and photothermal therapy, as well as gene therapy. So first we make some manganese containing and copper containing LDH nanoparticles. Yeah, we make easily in the lab, we make this. And very interestingly, these particles are not shown on the tissues, but are shown in the tumor tissues in the MRI imaging. So that's very interesting. Just show this. It's very efficient. And also we use a copper and artificially make some defects and enhance the photothermal conversion and used for photothermal therapy. So this can easily convert near infrared to heat and then heat-treated, tumors to prevent or cure tumors for imaging, yeah, and also for drugs to cure cancers. So this is a story, say, the imaging. So we make magnesium LDH BSA nanoparticles and then inject, IV inject. So in the first hour, before injection, we didn't see clearly the tumors right here. After injection, say 0.5 hour, 1 hour, 4 hour, until 72 hours, we can see the tumors becomes bright until 24 hours. And then the tumors brightly decay and almost disappear at 72 hours post IV injection. So the brightness can be actually quantified, show the similar information. So this profile just show LDH nanoparticles slowly accumulate at tumor tissues and reach the maximum at 24 hours. And then in the next 2 days, the accumulated nanoparticles are biodegradable and disappear. And we actually cut the tumor tissues at 24 hours. We see quite high amount of manganese accumulate tumors, much more than kidney and then in the liver. Why this is so efficient? Just because, say, at physiological solution, the relaxivity is very low. However, at pH 7 or 6.5, you see the T1 relaxivity increase about 6-7 times. So this is very efficient contrast for tumor tissues. And this contrast capability actually is 2 times of that of gadolinium DDPA. This is a gold MRI contrast agent. So these LDH nanoparticles show a very high sensitive to pH and very high capacity. So that's why we can see the tumor very clearly. Why? What's the reason? We thought after hydration in the slightly acidic solution, the OH group around magnetic center, they can be actually protonated. They form a temporary water. So this temporary water have a proteins very much closer to the magnetic center. So the relaxivity of this proton are significantly affected by this magnesium ion's magnetic field. So that's why it's so sensitive to the pH, just because a higher protons in solution facilitate the formation of temporary water. Okay, so in the second story, we make copper LDH with a 5FU loaded. And we also find, we make a different size, 25 nanometers, 200 nanometers, and 2 microns. And they show absorption for 808 nanometers near infrared. And this infrared can convert to heat. Say here, just show the heating profile. Actually, very interesting. The large particles have a little conversion, but the small particles, say 25 nanometers, have shown about 50% photothermal conversion. And this photothermal conversion actually relevant to pH in pH 6 buffer, that photothermal conversion increased to 65%. So that's also a pH enhanced photothermal conversion. And also copper actually have a unpaired electrons that can also show some MRI relaxivity. This also pH relative. So at pH 7.5, there's almost no relaxivity. But at pH 6.5 and pH 5, they have a relaxivity comparable to that of gold, gadolinium DDPA. So this also can be interesting and can be used for MRI imaging. Let me show you. So here we make these particles and make imaging. We see at 24 hours, we see a bright tumor imaging, right? Tumor. So these are intensity actually show the similar profile as a manganese. So at 24 hours, they reach a maximum. The intensity is a maximum. Later on, we also get the tumor and quantify how much copper in the tumor. And we find that, say, 24 hours, about 3.5%. Here. So it's 3.5 of inject dose accumulate in tumor. After that, the nanoparticles biodegrade and the copper just gone. So the signals degrade. Okay. So we make, so this is the imaging. We also do some chemotherapy, right? Chemotherapy and the phototherapy. So we use a chemotherapy, say, here, use a and also photothermotherapy, and then combining. Note here the dose of copper and 5FU actually is very, very low. It's about 5 to 10 times less than the report dose in other papers. So we do this injection at day 0, and then day 8, a lot of injection. And then in the second day, because accumulation reached the maximum, right? So then we do a NIR radiation at 1 watt per centimeter square for 3 minutes. And we see there's a heating produced. And then we monitor tumor growth. Say in the control group, we see it grow very quickly. And we use a chemotherapy. This is just small amount. So the inhibition is not obvious. Very interesting, we use a low dose of copper, and that actually after two treatments, and then in the first 2 weeks, control tumor grows very well. Only in the last 10 days, the tumor come back and recurs. Very interesting, in combined therapy, we see the tumor growth inhibition is very efficient. Actually, in the 8 mice, 7 mice are tumor-free. Only 1 mice have some tumors. So this very efficient treatment combined to even at a low dose. Why? Okay, later on we'll explain. And then say we see here, these are 6.5 ID that can accumulate at tumor tissues. We can ask ourselves, can it can be more? Can accumulate more? Basically, we can consider two factors. If we can make a lung circulation, so the particles have a lung circulation, or can be easily deposited at tumor size, and then we can actually increase the accumulation of LDH nanoparticles at tumor tissue. So we do the five part, we enhance, use a strategy to enhance LDH nanoparticles in the tumor microenvironment. So strategy is here. We do not use BSA, but use a charge convertible PEG based polymer. We know the PEG, the nanoparticles is a positive charged. We use a PEG based polymer that is electrically charged to coat nanoparticles. And these polymers are actually charge convertible at pH 6, 8. So at pH 6.8, the polymer become positive charge and take off from the particles. So expose nanoparticles. So in this process, we inject nanoparticles, we hope can achieve smooth and smooth circulation in the blood and have a lung circulation. Once they reach the tumor tissues, they will take off the polymer coatings and readily deposit in the tumor extracellular. And that actually exposed the positive charged LDH nanoparticles, and that can be readily uptake by the cells. So that is our strategy. And then we test the charge conversion. Say at pH 7, they are negative charged. At pH 6.8, they become positive charged. Because take off the coating, so the particle size becomes smaller. Comparably, the BSA coated particles no change at pH 7 and pH 6.8. And this change actually is dynamic. The change about 1 hour, they were completely. So we see at 6.8 pH, we see that these coated polymer particles, these coated nanoparticles become very clear hexagonal sheet. In the other case, the polymer coating, the BSA coating are clear there. So that because at 6.8, the amide group of the polymer broke. So these are exposed amino group. That amino group actually can be easily protonated, become positive charged. So that's why the polymer can change the charge from negative to positive. And that can also show after explosion at 6.8, the B16 cancer cells take up more nanoparticles and raw take up more. And in case of BSA coating, that not much change, okay? And also accumulation here just show very clearly BSA coating accumulate 24 hours reach maximum, and the polymer coating we can reach much more. Actually at 24 hours we measure the copper amount, and we see the copper amount increased to 6.86% of inject dose compared about 3% of inject dose. And more interestingly, in the spleen, that elective charged polymer actually prevent liver and spleen catch up, so elongate circulation in the blood. Of course, here just show the heat conversion is very efficient and also very low dose of very low density of NIR laser. So this, and finally we do this treatment, we can see at very low dose copper and no dose of siRNA, we can achieve very efficient tumor inhibition. Okay, that almost similar to previously, there's no growth. Okay, so that actually is relevant to the tumor microenvironment features. Here we just show, okay, the features is a pH 6.5, so that can enhance relaxivity for imaging, enhance PPT conversion efficiency, and more importantly, they can facilitate the 5FU release in the tumor, in tumor tissues. So this is a release mechanism. Okay, anyway, so in summary, so core delivery of two therapeutics led to a significant cytotoxicity to cancer cells. And LH nanoparticles can well colloidally stabilize with BSA coating and negative charged polymers. So our manganese and copper containing LH nanoparticles have a very high pH sensitive and can be a very good MRI contrast agent for tumor diagnosis. And sheet LDH nanoparticles efficiently accumulate in tumor tissues. And charge convertibility enable more LDH nanoparticles to accumulate in the tumor tissues for bad tumor therapy. Thank you for your attention.